Penguin Random House Audio presents Prequel, An American Fight Against Fascism. This is the author, Rachel Maddow. Author's note. There were millions of words written about the rise of and fight against fascism as it was happening in pre-World War II America. Material in books, magazines, newspapers, congressional hearings, government investigations, FBI files, trial transcripts, personal correspondence, etc. This makes for many big haystacks to search for many hidden needles. Luckily, I had the benefit of a remarkable amount of recent scholarship by really impressive historians who had already done some serious sifting. Among the most important to this book are Stephen J. Ross, who wrote Hitler in Los Angeles, Charles R. Gallagher, who wrote Nazis of Copley Square, Bradley W. Hart, who wrote Hitler's American Friends, and Nancy Beck Young, who wrote Why We Fight, Congress and the Politics of World War II. These four not only are friends to this book, but were friends to the podcast that first got me going on this topic. Outside of that small group, I need to acknowledge a few other historians and writers, all of whom were key to my understanding both specific pieces of this sprawling story and the larger context. These are James Q. Whitman, who wrote Hitler's American Model, Laura B. Rosenzweig, who wrote Hollywood's Spies, Mark Lamster, who wrote The Man in the Glass House, Gerald Horn, who wrote The Color of Fascism, Rodri Jeffries Jones, who wrote The Nazi Spy Ring in America, and Stephen Watts, who wrote The People's Tycoon. I should also mention that there are a bunch of great, very readable contemporaneous sources that you won't regret spending time with if you're lucky enough to find them in used bookstores. I commend to you Henry Reed Hoke, who wrote both It's a Secret and Blackmail. Also John Roy Carlson, who wrote Undercover. Michael Sayers and Albert E. Kahn, who wrote Sabotage. And O. John Rogge, who wrote The Official German Report. There's also Lawrence Dennis's own published account of being a defendant in the Great Sedition Trial. It's called A Trial on Trial. Academic sources and biographies on this topic are spare and sometimes even harder to find than the really old stuff. But there are some great ones out there that were indispensable to this work. Glenn Janson's Women of the Far Right, Leo P. Rebuffo's The Old Christian Right, Donald Warren's Radio Priest, Neil M. Johnson's George Sylvester Viereck, and Harnett T. Kane's Huey Long's Louisiana Hayride. Prologue. The House of the Vampire arrived in 1907 with a pinch of Bram Stoker's Dracula, a dash of Swinburne, and a major crush on Oscar Wilde. Two of the novella's main characters, Jack and Ernest, were named after the split personality lead character in Wilde's play, The Importance of Being Earnest. In The House of the Vampire, the hero, Reginald Clark, is a handsome, middle-aged boulevardier, bon vivant, and night prowler. Reginald Clark is also a magnet for impressionable and gifted young males, often ones with fetchingly long eyelashes, always with, quote, subtler, more sympathetic, more feminine ways than the general run of men. The book's 22-year-old author, George Sylvester Viereck, he went by Sylvester, which sounded more continental, was himself a pillow-lipped and self-professed sensualist who said he worshipped Oscar Wilde as one of his three life models, alongside Napoleon and Christ. Viereck wrote, "Wilde is splendid. I admire, nay, I love him. He is so deliciously unhealthy, so beautifully morbid. I love all things evil. I love the splendor of decay, the foul beauty of corruption." Sylvester, at age 17, had struck up an apparently romantic friendship with Wilde's most notorious paramour, Lord Alfred Douglas. Young Viereck also loved to show off the framed violet he said he had plucked from Wilde's grave. The House of the Vampire is seen today by precisely no one as the world's greatest gay vampire fiction. But it does have the distinction of being the world's first known publication in that now familiar genre. Viereck's hero vampire, Reginald, swaggers through the book, seducing younger men, gently tugging them away from the unerringly difficult or hag-like women who otherwise seek their attentions. Viereck writes of Reginald, quote, "A tremendous force trembled in his very fingertips. He was like a gigantic dynamo, charged with the might of 10,000 magnetic storms." In Viereck's voluptuous, pretentious, deeply stupid romp, Reginald is seeking not blood, like Bram Stoker's original vampire, but something more rarefied. He squeezes from his prey every drop of literary, musical, and aesthetic juice that they possess, quote, "absorbing from life the elements essential to artistic completion," as the hero explains. By the novel's close, everybody is drained but vampire Reginald. Viereck wrote about his first novel, "In every age, there have been great men, and they became great by absorbing the work of other men. My vampire is the overman of Nietzsche. He is justified in the pilfering of other men's brains." Viereck loosed his pioneering book on the world in 1907 with considerable hopes. He wrote to one critic, "You've heard of the great American novel? Well, I've written it." The critics did not agree. One wrote, "The style of the book was quite impossible, keyed from the first word to the last in the highest pitch of emotion." Still, though, the book did sell, and it even had its own brief run on the stage in an adaptation by a man who later co-wrote the screenplay for The Wizard of Oz. George Sylvester Viereck had been born in Munich and immigrated to America with his parents in 1896, when he was 11 years old. He had always been drawn to the memory and the landscape of his birthplace. There was mystery and intrigue in Sylvester's family history in Germany, including unproved claims to royal lineage. Viereck's father, Louis, was rumored to be the issue of a brief affair between a famous stage actress in the Prussian royal court and Kaiser Wilhelm I. The Kaiser, if he was indeed the father, was in no position to acknowledge this son, and he never did. Royalty or not, Louis ended up a Marxist, joining the anti-monarch Socialist Party in Germany and possibly getting involved in a plot to assassinate the Kaiser. This tale seems a tad on the nose in the Oedipal sense, but it is true that Louis was run out of Berlin, and then Munich, and then all of Germany on account of his Marxist proclivities. He landed in New York, but not exactly on his feet. Sylvester's father never found much success in the New World. He organized German Americans in support of presidential candidates William McKinley and Theodore Roosevelt. He wrote a forgotten monograph on German language instruction in American schools. He gave the occasional lecture on German culture and society. But for his young son, Sylvester, rife as he was with artistic gifts and a robust, unerring self-confidence in those gifts, Louis was a distant and feckless father. While Louis eventually ended up putting his tail between his legs and going back to Berlin to finish out his days giving lectures, this time about American culture and society, his son Sylvester, naturalized citizen of the United States, decided to stay put in New York, an electrified city in an up-and-coming country, a place with a trajectory matched to his own arcing ambition. By the time he was in his mid-20s, the flop of The House of the Vampire notwithstanding, Sylvester Viereck was recognized as a rising star in American literature. He had published a volume of well-regarded poems. Whispers that he was maybe the grandson of Kaiser Wilhelm I were probably good for sales, and also for contributing to the almost inexplicably fawning publicity he had a knack for attracting. One glossy middlebrow magazine wrote about Viereck that he was, quote, the most widely discussed literary man in the United States today. Unanimously accused.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.